Ryan, I'm having trouble focusing. It's blurry.
All right, hold on. Let me see. All right, well, try closing an eye.
Got it.
How's it look now?
Can't see anything at all.
Close the other eye, John.
Oh yeah, that's way better.
All right, folks, we have a new series for you, and it's going to be a grand old time. We're getting into long-range precision shooting. This is not a game that I am proficient in. I'm just going to learn. So I was a former door kicker in Ranger Battalion. I linked up with a Ranger buddy. I'd never met him before. This is Ryan Cleckner, wrote the book Long Range Shooting Handbook. I read it, and it kind of walked me through some of the initial steps. But I want you to meet him so that you can learn as well. We'll have a whole bunch of these videos, but without further ado, here's Ryan Cleckner. Guys, look at him. He's got a beard. He looks fantastic.
What's up, man? Good to see you.
Man. Cool. So first off, I read your book, then I tried to get some of the right equipment, and some of these guys who are wanting to get into this as well, tell them what they need to know, man.
Yeah, a lot of people are worried about getting into long range because they focus on the gear too much. They focus on what scope do I need and what rifle do I need and what grain bullet. And if you get so down into the minutia that it's not even fun anymore, I ask why you're doing it. The point is, if you want to learn long range shooting, get a scope that's good enough. Get a rifle that's good enough and spend some money on some training. Whether it's books or videos or just getting out there and practicing, don't overdo it at first. I mean, it's up to you for what your budget's gonna be. If you had to choose between a nicer rifle or a nicer scope, I would almost always encourage someone to get a nicer scope.
Cool.
Not only because the adjustments are gonna be more precise, it's gonna be clearer to see, you're gonna have more confidence in the system, but when you're ready to finally upgrade, selling a used scope is almost impossible to do, but you can sell a used rifle. So get the scope you're gonna grow into and get a good enough rifle now. Shoot the snot out of that thing, and when you're ready to upgrade, trade it in for a nicer rifle underneath that scope.
Very good. Ryan had different sections of his book that dealt specifically with the blasters, the optics, and all the stuff, all the questions. So I benefited from that, and you made some recommendations. I ended up going, I went with some of your recommendations. We had some phone calls and figured out some more stuff. So my first thing is, let me get just kind of a really nice gun and a setup, but it was a little bit more budget friendly. That's what this attempt was. So this is my gun. Interstate Guns was the one that supplied this stuff. They are sponsoring all these videos. Thank you, Interstate Guns. And I think they got a code War Poet that helps you with optics. Anyway, plug complete. So this is my budget setup. This is kind of medium cup of porridge. This is a nicer setup. And then we have your pro setup. So let's talk with budget.
All right.
Medium budget, high budget.
Okay, these are all fine scopes. They're all good. When you're looking for in a long-range shooting scope, yes, it's clarity, but don't get wrapped around the axle on that. I mean, a clear scope's a clear scope. Don't spend an extra $1,000 to have that much more clarity. What you're looking for is repeatability. You want to know that every time you come to the range, that zero is still that zero, or when I adjust up a certain distance to hit a target, that it really adjusted that. Does that make you nervous?
Yeah, well, we just stop it. We just zeroed it. Now I'm all screwed up. We just spent the morning zeroing
and
all this stuff.
And now we're back, guys.
I don't have the confidence in this stuff that I do in like my ARs and pistols. I'm like, they're freaking tools. And I like slam them on the table. I'm like, it's fine. It's good. If that hurts it, you should get better.
Exactly right. So that's what you're paying for here. So in the difference between this scope and this scope, sure, the glass is a little bit nicer. It is the adjustments and the repeatability, so the confidence in it. When I adjust this thing up maybe 3 mils and I adjust this scope up maybe 3 mils, it's more likely that this one's going to be an actual 3 mil adjustment and this one might be a small percentage points off. Or every time I go to 3 and back, it might be a little different on that scope.
Screw with your own stuff. Right. This is mine.
Guys.
I was kidding. Stop. No.
It's not going to
hurt
anything.
How do you know how many times you went? So
when we head up to the hill and we start shooting at distance, I will show you how we do
you
that.
You don't. He doesn't know anything.
Stop. So just. This is what you're paying for, guys. You're paying for the durability of the scope. You're paying for the repeatability of the adjustments. If this is what you can afford, get it. You will be happy with it. It'll work for you. However, if you can afford a little bit nicer, even if that means you save some money on the rifle, the Gen 2 of the Viper PSTs here from Vortex is a really nice scope. The Gen 2 is much better than the first gen. Matter of fact, the Gen 2 Viper PST actually catches you up to the Razor a little bit. It gets pretty darn close.
That's awesome.
And Vortex does that on purpose. They bring out the Gen 2 of the lower models, and then they kind of leapfrog everything up for the quality and performance. So this right here is what I would recommend for most people as what I call like a prosumer grade scope. It's everything you're gonna need for hunting, tactical shooting on your own. It's not the best, but it'll get you by. If you're on a budget, get it, okay? I'm not gonna judge anybody for what they can afford or what they can't, but if there's a difference, spend a couple hundred extra dollars on this one.
Got it.
And save a couple hundred dollars on the rifle.
So we're gonna have down below in the video description all the optics and accessories, and we'll even number the builds for you in case you wanna check that out. Stay with us, check that later. This is a BERGARA, really good gun, mm-hmm. and this is a Vortex, what is this?
Diamondback.
Diamondback, so not a very expensive, what is this setup? And then Harris bipod.
Yeah, I like the Harris bipods. I know some people like to get the fancier bipods, but.
It's not as expensive. This is more expensive. This right. is a Tika rifle. You have one as well.
Yep, I love the Tika rifle. The BERGARA is a great rifle too. It really, really is. Just there's certain things about the Tikas that I personally prefer. And I have some obscenely expensive guns. I do, but the one I find myself grabbing when I come to the range, I bring that Tika out. It's the same gun you can buy. So whatever people get, when they get the scope and the rifle they want, I see almost every single rifle of any student I've ever had, including professional military police snipers, across the board, almost everybody has the rifle set up improperly. I will spend the first day of a sniper course, even for these guys that are just champing at the bit to get going, and they feel like we're going too slow that first morning of taking their scopes off or making them set up their focus, and I find out that invariably they're almost all wrong. So when you guys get one, don't just have the gun shop put it on for you and think it's good. I make the analogy in the book that it's like a race car driver driving a car with the pedals and the steering wheel adjusted wrong. No matter how good you are, you're not gonna get the performance you want.
Gotcha.
Same thing here. When you set this thing up, take the time to go watch videos on it, go learn from somebody, but make sure that you're in a comfortable position and you move the scope and you move the cheek rest and you move everything so that the scope lines up perfectly with your eye, and take the time, like we did out here already, to adjust that ocular focus for your eye before you start messing with anything else. Because if this is set up wrong, you're gonna spend years and who knows how much money on ammo missing targets until you get it right.
In his book, he walks you through that with all kinds of plumb line stuff and figuring out how to level stuff. It's probably, as I was reading, I'm like, all right, that's pretty helpful. I don't trust myself without somebody actually there.
Yeah.
So you'd get the optic, you'd get the rings, you'd get the base if you need it. Those are the three things you'd need.
Uh-huh.
What is a dummy's version of, I don't have someone to walk me through it, get me close enough until I can find somebody professional.
Okay. On a standard scope base, on a rifle where you don't have a full length rail like this, you have, let's say, a hunting rifle or a rifle like this BERGARA here, I'm almost always gonna want the rings further forward, okay? I've never seen a scope where I've had the rings too far forward. So I'm gonna put the ring in the first couple notches on the base by itself. Here's just fine. Mm-hmm. So the first three notches is where I'm gonna put the first ring. I'm only gonna put the bottom half of the ring.
So we zeroed me right here, and mm-hmm. I didn't know exactly where to put it. I know LPVOs, and I know red dots on ARs, that's about it. Mm-hmm. But if you had your druthers, when we were done here, would I go ahead and push it forward and re-zero?
Oh yeah, so the idea is if you really are gonna have a gun that you're gonna work with, is you gotta start from scratch. Even if you had a gun that someone else had that you liked, start from scratch. Take it off, move the rings where they need to be. Small little tips, like when you put the ring in the rail, there's gonna be a little bit of a slop in the rail, always have it all the way forward.
Yeah.
Because under recoil, it's going to move forward on the gun. So you move it forward, you tighten it down, then I put the scope on.
Push it forward and to the right wherever.
I don't care about the side because the tightening knobs will pull it side to side, but I care for forward. Then I put the scope in, and if you are worried about your scope hitting the ground, I'll put these on very loose as like a seatbelt to keep the scope from falling off. That's when you get behind the rifle and get comfortable. Eyes closed, get comfortable behind the rifle. Having a friend help you with it is really, really nice to do. And only when you're in the position you want to be and you can open your eyes and see clearly through the scope are you set up. If you're not, if you open your eyes and you need to move your head, well, that muscle that you need to use to move your head up is going to get really fatigued after about 10 minutes of shooting.
Gotcha. So I sat down behind the gun,
yep.
and Ryan and I already did this. What were some things that you immediately adjusted me on?
Well, one of the first things I'm going to do, and this one is almost never people have adjusted right, is the ocular focus.
Right.
Is if you've ever shot through a scope and had the problem where the reticle's clear and then it's not, and then the target's clear and then it's not, you play that dancing game with your eye, you are set up for failure. So what we do is we want to get the scope focused for your eyeball so that your eye can see the reticle that's right there in the scope clearly.
Right.
And the only way to do that is to not focus on the target. So I love taking a white sheet of paper, or if you're inside, put a wall real close. Have the shooter sit down, and it is helpful with a friend here. If you don't have any friends, pay somebody. And you have the person that's on the gun keep their eyes closed, open their eye to look at the reticle, and then close their eye right away.
Right.
If they don't do that, their eye is going to flex and force it to be in focus. Have the other person turn this setting a couple turns.
Thanks.
I just freaked
awesome.
You out.
Great.
Have them open their eye again and then close it, and all I want to hear is whether it was better or worse than last time. And then you keep adjusting through the range, all directions, until you get it perfectly clear. Once you're set, now you know that your eye is set up for that reticle, so now when I adjust this target focus, I can bring the target image in line with that reticle. Not only are they both clear, so I'm not playing that dancing game, but when I move my head, if I do it all, they stay together, parallax free.
Awesome.
So that is so important that if the gun is set up for me, you're not gonna get as good a performance out of it as you would if it's set up for you.
Copy.
So you can't just jump on somebody else's gun and expect it to be right for you.
All right, what about caliber?
So shoot what is comfortable for you to shoot at the distance you wanna shoot. So
I want to stack bodies at 5 miles away. You mean comfortable for everyone? That's what they want.
Yeah.
Yes, I want to.
So at any given time, we all want the biggest possible caliber.
I want to shoot around. I want to shoot around, have it wrap around the world, and hit an ISIS warfighter in the back of the head.
We all do.
So what setup do I need to do to pull that off?
So the problem with the caliber discussion is every year manufacturers come out with the new coolest round that's supposed to do everything better than everything else did before it, and I just don't buy into that game. I'm very reluctant to buy into the newest, latest cartridge.
Right.
I was a 308 guy for a long time, not only because I spent a lot of time on taxpayers' dollars learning how to shoot a 308,
yeah.
But when I look downrange and I see the wind, I see it in 308.
Right.
I have to convert from that to other things. So when 6.5 Creedmoor came out, it was the newest, greatest thing, and everyone was adopting it. I wasn't. It took me until just recently, just late last year, I finally adopted the 6.5 Creedmoor.
You're such a FUD.
Well, if I would have jumped on that bandwagon, I would have had the 260 Remington,
yeah.
10 years prior. And now I would have had all these 260 Remington guns and it wouldn't have fit. So it's just always something else better comes out. I'm always worried about supply chain. 308 I could find in any NATO country. I could go on a hunting trip somewhere and forget my ammo and go to a local Walmart and pick some up. But now the 6.5 Creedmoor has caught on so much. Now that SOCOM has officially adopted, and they're making belt-fed machine guns with 6.5 Creedmoor now. Okay, I've seen the belt. So, 6.5 Creedmoor is here to stay.
Yeah.
And I actually happened to be in a Walmart the other day looking at the ammo section, and I saw one more SKU of 6.5 Creedmoor than I did 308.
Wow.
Okay, now it's time to switch.
It's time.
So I finally adopted the 6.5 Creedmoor, and it also helped. I took it to Africa. I actually took this rifle here to Africa, and we slayed every Plains game that we shot with it, one-shot drops. I've seen the light, I get it now. I think there's no reason for anyone to do anything but 6.5 Creedmoor when it comes to target shooting. And if you want to use it for hunting, you can do it too.
And I took his advice, these are all 6.5, 6.5, 6.5, wait, what is this?
6.5.
6.5, 6.5, and then we have a 5.56 dancing around.
So you're gonna easily shoot out to 1,200 yards, maybe a little further with 6.5 Creedmoor, easily.
I think I'll get 1,300 pretty well.
So it's a
until you
low recoiling.
Until you adjusted my stuff.
Not very expensive. It's going to be fine, guys. Don't worry about it.
What I really like about Ryan, and before I'd met him, I was already reading his book, but he basically talked about the different schools of long-range precision shooting, and there's some of the guys that are the competition guys, and I mean, they've got their analytics and their calculators and their whatever, and I'm not ragging on ballistic calculators and having all that equipment, but I like the real world, no-nonsense mindset he brings in. He wants to be able to immediately know holds so that he can sit down and in a few seconds hit somebody moving at 600, reach out to 900, and so it's combat effectiveness. You don't have all day to make that shot. And so there's a little bit of a analysis paralysis that can be brought to the long range precision game. And Ryan doesn't have that. It's more of the practical. You have a very short amount of time sometimes. Get down and make the shot. And so it's kind of the good enough accuracy kind of stuff.
Absolutely how I say it. I say it's good enough accuracy. I'm the rare precision shooting guy that tries to not be too precise.
Which probably irritates the other high precision.
Absolutely. So you get the online discussions of people will drive them nuts on some of the things I say. It doesn't matter. I see more guys fail because they worry about so much precision that they never go out and practice.
Right. Well,
they never just go out and shoot. 1 minute of angle. I have guys online will scoff at 1 minute of angle. Oh, you shoot 1 minute of angle? Pfft, I shoot a quarter minute of angle. Here. 1 minute of angle is 10 inches at 1,000 yards. You're telling me you wouldn't be happy to pick up a rifle and hit a pie plate at 1,000 yards?
Yeah.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
So these guys that are worrying about quarter minute groups though at 100, they can't even hit the pie plate at 1,000 yards because they're never stretching out the rifle to check what's going on.
Yeah.
Or they're so down in the minutiae of what's going on that they get lost in actually learning how to shoot and have the fundamentals of shooting.
Yeah.
Or even worse, you guys, you might be so stressed out about all this that you never get started. I don't want that. I want to be the guy that says, yeah, it can be complicated, but it's not that hard.
Gotcha.
It's fundamentals of shooting. Get out there and get going. And if you're worried about the spin of the earth while you're still trying to work on your fundamentals, it's not the right thing to do.
I like the pragmatism of a warfighter because, I mean, you're seeing dudes downrange, and that was your context. It wasn't just pie plates that never move, right?
Right.
So anyway, I like that pragmatism. That's what I'm after, and that's why I came specifically to you. So guys, we're doing other videos on this, so how to set up a scope, some other accessory equipment, and other stuff in the series. Do you have like a little sign-off thing you do?
Or? No, second bat, best bat.
Second bat is the best bat. Rangers lead the way, trainers train smart.
They didn't number them by accident. First bat is first.
First bat is best bat when second bat is deployed overseas. You're the best in the country left behind.
All right, I'll take it.